Rakesh
Rakesh,
Nigam, sir.
thank you.
Yes.
Good evening to everybody. I welcome Dr. Velhankar, the retired professor of medicine from Bombay Veterinary College, and congratulate him for this marathon 7-day course of on ECG. And this is the 6th day, I think. And
yes,
I was
sir.
Told that so many, more than 400 and 500 participants have been joining every day. So this is really very good. I again congratulate Dr. Velhankar and welcome to in this course. The VIPM Society President Dr. Bikhane, Dean Akola, Veterinary College. General Secretary Dr. Ashok Kumar, Principal Scientist, CIRG. Dr. Mukesh, Organizing Secretary of this course. And the key persons from Alembic Pharma, who is a knowledge partner of this course. Mr. Karunanidhi, Dr. Santosh Shinde, Amit Singh, Naresh Kulkarni, and their participants from different corners of the country. I welcome you all, and hope this is the 6th day. So I'm joining my first day today. Dr. Mukesh told me, so I feel honored to honor you, sir, Dr. Velhankar. So thank you very much, Mukesh.
Thank you, sir.
I should again congratulate you for this great course you have been running throughout country. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. And without any delay, I welcome Velhankar, sir, for the lecture of today's session. Dr. Velhankar, sir, please start the today's session.
Thank you, Nigam, sir, for your appreciation for this work what I have been doing. So I thank you again. Dear participants, today is our penultimate day for this particular training program. And yesterday, as our usual practice, I'll recapitulate what we did yesterday, and then we'll begin our discussion on the topics of today. Yesterday, we saw what is non-compensatory pause and compensatory pause. In case of non-compensatory pause, it is seen with the AP, it is associated with APCs, in which the APCs reset the timing of the SA node. Whereas in case of the non-compensatory pauses, the compensatory pauses, they are associated with the VPCs, because they are not able to reset the timing of the SA node. And therefore you will find that always the distance between the two RR wave enclosing a normal sinus complex and distance between the two RR waves enclosing APC is always shorter. Whereas in case of the VPC, the distance between the two RR waves enclosing a normal complex and the distance between the two RR complexes enclosing a VPC, where the VPC is enclosed, it is always greater as compared to the normal three sinus complexes. So this is the compensatory and non-compensatory pause. This is particularly required whenever we are in a fuss, okay, whether the VPC, whether it is an APC or a VPC, because it has been given very close to the AV node. Then we have seen the treatment for ventricular tachycardia. We have seen the ventricular fibrillation, how it looks like. Then it has two types, the fine and the coarse. There are no PQRST, no baseline, but only you can see the undulations of the baseline. Then the treatment for the marathon treatment for ventricular fibrillation also we have seen. Now, in the conduction disturbances, we have seen the first degree heart block, which is detected by identified by delay in the conduction. And the electrocardiographically, you will find there is a prolongation of the PR interval. In the second degree heart block, there are two types. One is a Mobitz type 1 and Mobitz type 2. In Mobitz type 1, there is a progressive prolongation of the PR interval and the QRS complex is dropped. That is normal, that is the long end drop category. Whereas in case of the Mobitz type 2, you'll find the QRS is suddenly dropped. So that is normal, and the QRS is suddenly dropped. So this is the two categories of second degree heart block in which we identify on the ECG either a progressive prolongation of PR interval and then dropping of a PR, that is the P wave, without a QRS complex, that is the QRS complex is totally blocked. In Mobitz type 2, there is sudden dropping, there is no change in the PR interval of the complexes. Then third degree heart block or complete heart block, you will find there is no communication. All the impulses, without exception, they are dropped beyond the AV node. And therefore, the ventricles will beat at their own, the P wave will beat at their own, and therefore you'll find more P waves, ventricular rate is slow, and ventricles, they only give the escape beats. And so you will find that the P waves are without QRS complexes, and in between what you see, the electrical activity, because of the ventricles, are the escape beats. Then we are seeing the junctional escape beats and the ventricular escape beats. Now, when the pacemaker reaches to the higher pacemaker, like SA node fails to initiate the pulse or initiate the impulse, the next in command, that is the junctional tissue, will take up and it will fire the impulse. And therefore, in such cases, you will find the P wave is negative. And whereas in case even all this above centers, they fail, including in his Purkinje system, to fire the impulse, then the ventricular tissue at its own pace and as per its own timing and pulsation rate, it will fire up. I mean, it will bring about the depolarization to pace the heart. And therefore, this is called, and the what you see is a wide, bizarre complexes are seen on the electrocardiogram, and those we call it as escape beats. And since these escape beats, they are occurring at a very slow rate, and when they dominate the rhythm, we call it as escape rhythm. So this is what we saw yesterday, and today we'll be taking the remaining part of the conduction system and some other small topics. So I welcome you for this today's discussion. Now we have seen the three blocks, first degree heart block, second degree heart block, and third degree heart block. So now we are going to see the bundle branches blocks. Now in the His-Purkinje system, it divides into two parts, that is the left bundle branch and the right bundle branch. The left bundle branch has again two parts, the left anterior fascicle and left posterior fascicle. Left branch is little thicker as compared with the right one. The right one is thinner. Now, and they all run under the endocardial surface. Now, it refers to the disruption of the impulse transmission through the right and left bundle branch, right and left branches of the bundle of His. Now, in bundle branch blocks, depolarization of the ventricle occurs in an abnormal or aberrant sequence, and therefore QRS complexes, they become distorted. Because in bundle branch blocks, whenever there is a left bundle branch is blocked, then the impulse travels through the right bundle branch, and then it will depolarize. The impulse will bring about the depolarization of the right ventricle, and then the impulse will also bring up will be transmitted to the left ventricular myocardium, and it will bring about the depolarization of the left ventricle. And therefore, since the impulse travels to the ventricular myocardium, naturally, that speed of depolarization doesn't match with the normal conduction system speed, and therefore we get the complexes of wide and bizarre complexes in the bundle branch blocks. Now, therefore, since either the left or the right, the branch which is blocked, the conduction of that particular side is delayed. And therefore, this delay we see, or the reflection of that delay is seen on the electrocardiogram in the form of wide and bizarre complexes. Now, Now here we see the electrocardiogram of a right bundle branch block. Now in the right bundle branch block, what happens? The right branch is completely impulse doesn't travel through that, and therefore the left ventricle depolarizes first, and then then it brings about the impulse is conducted to the right ventricle, and then its depolarization is carried out. And therefore you will find that there will be a P wave up to here. It is normal, and then this is the is electrocardiographic picture what you get in the right bundle branch block. The S wave is big S wave negative and followed by a T wave. This wide bizarre appearance is because the impulse travels through the ventricular myocardium of the right side and not directly through the conduction system. So these are the pictures. We'll study the electrocardiographic. I'll just show you the description of this. You can see, but now remember, we'll differentiate it here from a VPC. This configuration confuses with the ventricular premature complex a lot, originating from the left side of the ventricle. But this is not a VPC. Why? Because here there is a P wave, and if you calculate the PR, all complexes are having a P wave, and the PR interval, if you calculate, it is exactly the same. So this doesn't go with the definition of the VPC, that they are not related with the P wave, but here they are related with the P wave. So these are not the VPCs, and it is a right bundle branch block. And second crude idea, what I generally tell students, that you remember the half part of our map of India. This is the Gujarat side, this is the South India, and this is our Seven Sister area. So this generally gives you an idea, yes, it is. And this portion is very important, that is the P waves. And this differentiates you that all complexes are associated with the P wave, and the PR interval is constant. So this is not a VPC, but it is a right bundle branch block. This is a left bundle branch. We'll discuss left bundle branch. We'll take actually. Now, right bundle branch block associations. It is most often seen as an accidental ECG finding. Number of times, whenever you take the ECG, you find there is a right bundle branch block, and it doesn't pose any problem with regard to the circulatory equilibrium of the body. It doesn't disturb, and therefore generally animal is perfectly clinically healthy, doing running, resting, barking. There is absolutely no problem with the dog, and generally we detect it when we take the ECG for something else. Now, congenital heart diseases, it is associated with that in human beings particularly. Now, chronic valvular fibrosis seen in normal healthy dogs without any apparent cause. Now, after cardiac arrest, it can occur. Then transient right bundle branch block, there it will be for a very short period, and then again it can go ahead. Then seen after surgical correction of ventricular septal defect. Yes, because right bundle branch block is very superficial. Then seen commonly in old dogs, but also reported in young dogs. Right bundle branch block doesn't appear to cause any cardiac dysfunction. Its clinical significance is that on ECG, it mimics severe right ventricular enlargement. Yes, as I told you. No clinical signs are attributable to the RBB and are not associated with the enlargement. I have told you to identify it, rule out the its mimicking with the right ventricular enlargement or VPC by the fact that they are associated with the P wave, and clinically the patient is very healthy. there are no signs. Now, physical examination, the helpful clue is split second sound due to the delayed right ventricular depolarization. The pulmonic valve closes split second earlier, later as compared than the aortic valve. This is because the left ventricle depolarizes early than the right ventricle. Now, this splitting may not be present in all the cases, remember. So, identification criteria is only the look at the ECG, see its association with the P wave, see the PR interval, if it is constant, and that means the P and these complexes are related. So, we can say it is safely, it's a right bundle branch block with a healthy, clinically healthy patient. Now, electrocardiographic diagnosis. Heart rate is usually normal. Rhythm regular unless sinus arrhythmia is present because dog is conscious and the dog is very excited in state, then sinus arrhythmia may be present. The P wave for QRS and QRS for every P wave were seen, that the complexes they are seen. The P waves and QRS complexes are related. We have seen that the PR interval was constant. The P waves are normal, but QRS complexes have wide and large S wave in lead 1, 2, 3, and AVF. And S wave is usually present in lead V10. So now we'll see this criteria regarding the lead S wave. I told you that there is a large S wave. See here. Do we have that type of, you can see the large S wave in lead 2. I try to take with 6 pictures. See here, we see that we want the large S wave in lead 1, lead 2, lead 3 and AVF. So there is a large S wave in all these leads. Then PR interval is constant for all the leads. It is associated with the P wave. There is a P wave and a large QRS complex with a large S wave in lead 1, lead 2, lead 3 and AVF. And there is a S wave, what it said, in lead V10. You can see this is the S wave in lead V10. So this is a diagnostic criteria. How are you going to record the lead 10, V10? That is it very easy. When you have to just put the electrode in between two scapulae at the 7 spinous process while recording the ECG on, just but putting on the recording the lead selector button on V. So that will give you the lead V10. It is the easiest way to record that. That means this lead is the easiest to record amongst all the four V leads. So this is the right bundle branch block. Here also you can see the association of P wave with the wide QRS, negative QRS complexes and the S wave is wide, large S wave. Again, this is the right bundle branch block showing you the association with the P wave. Now, sometimes what happens, the right ventricular enlargement and right bundle branch block. Because in your right ventricular enlargement, there is a right axis deviation may be present. And it can confuse our diagnosis with the right bundle branch, whether there is a right bundle branch block or there is a right ventricular enlargement. So in these cases, we take the thoracic radiograph. If severe enlargement is seen on the thoracic, that is the left lateral thoracic radiograph we take, and if we see there is a enlargement of the heart in the thoracic cavity, normally we say that whenever the X-ray is taken, the cardiac celloid should not extend more than 3 to 3.5 ribs distance. If it is more than that, we say there is a generalized cardiomegaly. And therefore, if severe enlargement is not seen, then it is right bundle branch block, and if there is an enlargement is seen in the thoracic cavity, in the cardiac celloid, we say it could be the right ventricular enlargement. And then, of course, for further diagnosis, we'll have to take the help of 2D echocardiography, which is a 2D and M mode, which are the gold standard tests for final diagnosis of the cardiac elements, both regard to the qualitative and quantitative assessment of the cardiac function. Now, VPCs and ventricular tachycardia of left ventricular origin can resemble right bundle branch block. I told you, we discussed it in the very initially, that the VPC of left ventricular origin, the VPC of left ventricular origin, when I have told you the while describing the VPCs, that if the T wave is above the baseline, it is left ventricular in origin. So this is a VPC. It looks like a configuration of a VPC with left ventricular origin. And if there is a tachycardia, you will find that the waves are very close, and then it may mimic this. VPCs may mimic the right ventricular, the right bundle branch block. And therefore, you have to differentiate that it is a VPC or it is a RBB. So in RBB, you will find this is your main clue that they are associated with the P wave and PR interval is constant. And secondly, there are no clinical signs of any other disease. The patient is clinically almost healthy. Now, as I told you, the RBB can be often permanent conduction abnormality without posing any threat to the circulatory equilibrium, but it can be sometimes transient or intermittent. Here you can see only the two of the bits. There was transient right bundle branch block for these two bits, and then again resumed the normal rhythm. So it can be, this is nothing but these two, the pair of complexes what you see is a nothing but they are the transient right bundle branch block. Why they are not VPCs? Because they have a PR interval and which is constant with as compared with the other complexes. So they are, this is a transient right bundle branch block. If one of the smaller ramifications of right bundle branch is blocked, then incomplete right bundle branch block results, that is the fascicular blocks. It is characterized by on the ECG by presence of large S wave in lead 1, 2, 3 and AVF, but their size and width is smaller. We have seen in the earlier ECG slide that with right bundle branch block, the S waves were very wide. Here, if a smaller ramification is blocked, then there will be some delay in the getting it depolarized, and therefore that delay, but it will not be as extensive as in case of the when the full branch is blocked. So you can see that the waves will be, their complexes will be of a smaller size and their width will be less. Here you can see the size of the S wave. You can see this is the T wave. So this is the P, Q, a small r, then S, and this is the T. Here also P, Q, small r here, and S, and this is the T. So here you will find the size of the complexes is smaller and they are less wide as compared to when we saw the slide with the complete right bundle branch. Now, the treatment for right bundle branch block, there is no specific treatment is required. for right bundle branch block. The therapy is directed at any other problem that dog might have, and usually an accidental finding. Now we go to left bundle branch block. Left bundle branch block is usually associated with cardiac diseases. But those have been reported by these research workers. Now it is commonly seen with severe left ventricular enlargement. Then clinical signs cannot be seen from arrhythmias, but cardiac decompensation is seen in dogs with myocardial disease or with left ventricular enlargement. Now, when we go to the physical examination, the split second sound may be heard as aortic valve closes late due to the delayed left ventricular depolarization. Now here, right ventricular is going to get depolarized first, followed by the left ventricle a split second later. And therefore, you'll find the pulmonic valve will get first closed and followed by the aortic valve will be closing a split second later as compared with the similar the other the AV valve. So in case of this split second sound, because of the delay in the left ventricular depolarization, this split second sound is heard, and this is due to the slight delay in the closure of the aortic valve. Now, ECG findings. The heart rate is usually normal. Rhythm is regular, or sinus arrhythmia is present. There will be P wave for QRS and QRS for P wave. None of them will be absent. They will be related. That means the PR interval will be constant, and P waves are normal in configuration. But for QRS complexes in right bundle branch block, they were negative. Here they are positive and wider than 0.07 seconds in the leads 1, 2, 3 and AVF. This is important diagnostic criteria or identification criteria for left bundle branch block, that QRS complexes are positive and wider more than 0.07 seconds. Our normal range is 0.05, not exceeding 0.05 seconds. And therefore, you'll find they are wider than 0.07 seconds in lead 2, 3, and AVF. Now, here you can see the wide QRS complexes. See the width. They are almost 0.8 to 0.9, 4.5 blocks. So 0.08 seconds wide. And the PR interval is 0.14 seconds, and which is constant here, what I calculated for you. Now, in these cases, one point I forgot to tell you, that whenever there is a left ventricular, left atrial enlargement, we have seen that the SA node fires its impulse, and that is therefore, and the right ventricular gets polarized 0.01 second earlier as compared with the left ventricle, left atrium. And therefore, you will find this first part is a right atrium. And then whenever the left atrium is enlarged, you'll find it will take a longer time to depolarize the left atrium. And at that time, what happens? There is a, you see, this a niche is formed here. And so whenever there is a niche formation here in the P wave, it is a characteristic of left atrial enlargement, formation of a notch in the P wave is an indication of left atrial enlargement. Remember, but this notch is insignificant if P waves are not wide. Remember that. So notching of the P wave is an indication of left atrial enlargement. And because I saw the notch here and then I just remembered, okay, I forgot this point to discuss. So the notching of the P wave is an indication of left atrial enlargement subject to if the P waves are wide, otherwise it is to be ignored. So in case of the left atrial enlargement, here in this case, the left bundle branch block, the QRS complexes are 0.08 second wide, but the PR interval, though it's 0.14 seconds, slightly wider, slightly more than the normal. So here we can say that these complexes are related with the P wave. They are wide, then more than 0.07 seconds. So they are. This is the clear-cut case of left bundle branch block, or you can say left ventricular enlargement also. So we'll have two criteria here to discuss, to compare, because the QRS complexes become wide whenever there is a left ventricular enlargement or there is a left ventricular hypertrophy. So therefore, you have to now take again the help of another modality, that is the X-ray. And in X-ray, if we find the heart is enlarged, then we say it cannot be the left bundle branch block, but it could be the extensive left ventricular enlargement. But if it is not there, if the silhouette of the cardiac cell 2 to 3.5 ribs distance, then we can say it is a, and still you get the QRS complexes width at 0.08, more than 0.07 seconds in lead 1, lead 2, lead 3 and AVF, then we say it's a left bundle branch block. In this you can see lead 1, the QRS complex is wider than 0.08, wider than 0.08, wider than 0.08. So lead 1, lead 2, lead 3, then AVF. So in all these cases, the complexes are positive, number 1. Number 2, the QRS complexes and the P waves, they are related. That is, PR interval is constant and the QRS complexes are wider than 0.08 seconds. So in this case, we say it is a left bundle branch block. But even then, we compare it with the X-ray. And on X-ray, if it is if the cardiac silhouette is within the normal limit, we always say, yes, it is a left bundle branch block. And if it is, the X-ray shows the wide, the big cardiac silhouette, then we again go in for the further modality, that is the echocardiography. Now treatment, no specific treatment for LVB is advised. If a myocardial disease is suspected, antibiotics and corticosteroids, if inflammatory lesion is causing the LVB. Signs of cardiac decompensation are treated symptomatically. Now, this was about the blocking of the main branches, that is the right branch, right bundle branch block completely here, or the left bundle branch block blocked here. So in this case, we'll find, and this was our complete heart block when nothing was allowed to pass beyond the AV node. So it was a case of complete heart block. Now this is the right bundle branch block, right bundle branch. This is the left, which is thicker, and it has two fascicles, the anterior fascicle, which is comparatively bigger as compared with the posterior fascicle. So the block can occur here, then that is in the anterior fascicle, in the posterior fascicle, in the, or it can occur in these two places, that is the right is also blocked and the left anterior is also blocked. So at these three places, the fascicular blocks can commonly occur or you encounter them. So now let us study one by one. Now the block in the anterior and posterior fascicle causes slight prolongation of left ventricular depolarization. Anterior fascicular block common, anterior fascicular block, generally it's common in cats. Then it is also seen in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Of course, dogs generally do not suffer from hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. They have dilated cardiomyopathy issues. Then anterior fascicle is more vulnerable because it has a different blood supply. Then it is longer and thinner, as I told you. Located in the turbulent outflow tract of the left ventricle. So that is the reason why it make, why it is prone for getting damaged, and then the having and due to the damage the conduction fails. Now electrocardiographic finding. If there is anterior left anterior fascicular block, then how the ECG of that particular patient would look like? The QRS complex's width is prolonged, and it will be between 0.06, 0.04 to 0.06. There will be marked left axis deviation. That is the mean mean electrical axis will be minus 60. Now small, the very small Q waves and tall R waves in lead 1 and AVL. Then deep S waves in lead 2, lead 3 and AVF. And other causes of this ECG pattern to be ruled out. So now this is a one strip which I rhythm strip which I kept taken from the website for the demonstration purpose, and here we find that there is a left anterior fascicular block. So as per those criteria, you can find there is a left axis deviation. So in this we'll find the this particular lead as per our definition, that the lead having some total electrical activity close to zero or zero. So AVR is close to zero. So AVR is our lead, that is AVR is a lead which is isoelectric. So as per the definition, the mean electrical axis will be at 90 degrees to this lead. And therefore this is lead 3. Now check the polarity of lead 3 in the strip. It is negative. So the negative pole of this lead 3 is your, the value of negative lead of this 3 is your mean electrical axis. So this is the positive electrode of 3, that is 120, plus 120. And negative is minus 60. Minus 60 is extreme left axis deviation. So there is a, in the left anterior fascicular block, so that I mean qualifies that there is a extreme left axis deviation. This is a, again, case of left axis deviation. Here also you can see that lead AVR is isoelectric, and you'll find the minus 60, as we calculated just now for this, that slide, the minus 60 is a your lead mean electrical axis, indicating it's a extreme left axis deviation. Now, sometimes it happens that the left right bundle branch block and left anterior fascicular block, they occur together, and then the combination of their ECG features is seen in the Ridden strip. Now, in case of the RBB, we have seen the complexes were wide and they were negative, but associated with the P wave. So the QRS complex were wider. So the duration is 0.06 seconds or greater. Then anterior fascicular block has the extreme left axis deviation that is more than greater than minus 60. Then wide and deep S waves in lead 1, 2, 3 and AVF, like a right bundle branch block and CV6LU. Then tall R waves and small Q waves in 1 and AVL. Then QRS complexes in CV5RL has RSR, that is a big tall R, and or RSR pattern that appears M-shaped. Now we'll see all these descriptions and verify them on the ECG. See now, the first says the QRS complexes are 0.06 seconds wide. You can see here they're more than three blocks wide. So in lead, then there is a marked left axis deviation. So if we see which lead is isoelectric, then wide and deep S waves in lead 1, 2, 3 AVF and CV6LU. 2, 3, AVF, you can see the 1, 2, 3 and AVF, you will see the wide S waves. Here is the S wave for lead 1. Then tall R waves and small Q waves in lead 1 and AVL. This is the R wave for lead 1. And AVL. Generally, they are not seen here. They are not big. This AVL is a negative lead generally, what you get. Then QRS complexes in CV5RL has RSR pattern and you can see it here. It looks like a formation of a M, RSR pattern. It appears M-shaped. So these criteria generally are characteristic or identifying features of RBB and left anterior fascicular blocks. The associated conditions are hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, restrictive cardiomyopathy, left ventricular hypertrophy, hyperkalemia, causes of hyperkalemia. Treatment: the fascicular blocks themselves do not cause hemodynamic abnormalities. The therapy directed at the primary cause, and RBB and left anterior fascicular block may develop second or third degree AV block and making treatment essential. So here you see the right bundle branch block in the cat and the left LAB. This is only a the strip lead 2. So this was about the bundle branch blocks. And now we'll be discussing the three topics which are now remaining. One is a sinoatrial standstill and the aberrant conduction and the six sinus syndrome. So now this, in sinus atrial standstill, it is also called as the SAS or silent atrium. Now this is actually not a true block. This is an arrhythmia that is characterized by total absence of atrial depolarization. Atrium doesn't depolarize despite the normal impulse is conducted to the SA node via internodal fibers, and ventricle depolarization is occurring at a regular interval. And therefore, since the impulse is directly conducted from SA node to the ventricles, it is also called as sinoventricular rhythm. Now, this type of atrial standstill is rare in dog and somewhat less in cat. Now, there are two categories. One is anatomic or structural and functional. Structural or anatomic lesion is like atrial parenchymal hypoplasia that has been reported, and particularly common in Springer Spaniels due to the dystrophic neuromyopathy. This is a pathological finding, what they observed in the dog died of this particular symptom. Then functional is due to the severe hyperkalemia with levels of potassium more than 7.5 milliequivalent. Because as we know, the myocardium is very sensitive to the potassium. So the conditions causing hyperkalemia, like adrenal insufficiency or end-stage renal failure, they are most frequently occurring causes of hyperkalemia and atrial standstill. Now, the dogs with cardiac arrest also show this type of rhythm. As I told you, it's the rhythm of a dog which is about to die or dying. So it's a pre-death rhythm. The ventricles do not get the ventricles do get the stimulation from higher pacemakers. They beat at their own speed, and therefore it's a idioventricular rhythm. Symptoms are profound weakness, collapse, coma due to asystole and poor cardiac output, severe hypotension, then GI tract upsets, history of episodes of exercise intolerance, weakness, and lethargy. When physical examination, if you auscultate, you'll find the bradycardia, the heart rate will be less than or equal to 60. And whenever the profoundly weak or comatose dog with bradycardia is present, SARS should be considered as possible diagnosis. And there is a total silence between the ventricular beats and no jugular pulse. Now we come to the electrocardiographic finding, how the ECG looks like. The bradycardia is present, heart rate less than 60. The rhythm may be regular or irregular. There are no P waves. QRS complexes occur alone with a straight, steady baseline between them. Yesterday, I think, or day before yesterday, you were asked this question in your quiz. So there are no P waves and QRS complexes occur alone with a straight steady baseline in between them. Since no P waves, no PR interval. QRS complexes are near to normal if they arise near bundle of face, or bizarre if they originate in ventricular muscle mass. The main characteristic feature or to diagnose this condition is absence of P waves and slow idioventricular rhythm with smooth, steady baseline between ventricular complex. So absence of P waves and slow idioventricular rhythm with smooth, steady baseline between the ventricular complexes. absence of P waves is also there whenever there's atrial fibrillation. But in atrial fibrillation, the baseline is not steady. It is undulating and it has the baseline fasciculations which are replaced with F waves. And secondly, the you can see the heart rate is high. So you can see the activation of the ventricles is at a rapid rate, even though it is irregular, but it is at a rapid rate. But here you will find it's a slow idioventricular rhythm. So QRS complexes will not be, the heart rate is also slow. It is, that is, there is a bradycardia less than 60. So this is a sinoatrial standstill with a dog with Addison's disease, hyperkalemia. And you'll find this is a steady baseline, no P waves. So the ventricles are beating at their own wish and will. So these are not the VPC, these are the ventricular escape beats. So identifying feature of the sinoatrial standstill ECG is absence of P waves and a straight steady baseline with between the these escape beats. So this is a criteria, identifying criteria for this particular condition, that is the sinoatrial standstill. Treatment for hyperkalemia includes intravenous dextrose and saline, IV and iron hydrocortisone, 11-desoxycorticosterone acetate, which is a sodium. It is a sodium sparing mineralocorticoid by IM root, soda bicarb, and insulin. So insulin pumps the potassium back into the cells. This is the mechanism that it shifts the potassium into the cells by stimulating the activity of sodium and hydrogen antiporters on the cell membrane, and promoting the entry of sodium into the cells, and via sodium potassium ATPase, causing an electrogenic flux of potassium. And therefore, the IV insulin leads to the dose-dependent decline of serum potassium levels. Therefore, this helps in pushing the sodium potassium back into the cells, which is its normal, actually, the location. Intravenous dextrose and saline to maintain the circulating blood volume. IV fluid containing 1 milligram of isoproterenol in 200 to 250 ml of fluid, because isoproterenol improves heart rate and myocardial contractility too. Soda bicarb, because the heart rate is low, so carbon dioxide accumulation is going to give the it is going to cause the acidosis, and therefore to reverse that, we are using the soda bicarb. Atropine sulfate can be given if SARS is due to the vagal inhibition. Prognosis, SARS has a grave prognosis, and the treatment initiated immediately, and the dog can undergo cardiac arrest at any moment. So this was about the sinoatrial SARS. So now we come to the second topic, that is the sick sinus syndrome. Or this is also called as the bradycardia tachycardia syndrome. This syndrome involves a complex disturbance of cardiac conductive tissues producing a simultaneous defect in sinus activity. It is a complex arrhythmia. That is, there will be sinus bradycardia and SA block. Conduction disturbances of first and second degree AV blocks. Then disturbances in supraventricular and ventricular excitability. Therefore, you find the complex that you will find in certain places in the cardiac activity, there will be bradycardia. Suddenly, there will be tachycardia syndrome. So it is called as bradycardia tachycardia syndrome. Hence, this disturbance is not only limited to the SA node, as the name suggests, but it is an illness that affects cardiac tissues at all levels. The etiology of sick sinus syndrome is not known. There is a sex predilection. The female dogs are more commonly affected. Breed specificity, the miniature schnauzers most commonly affected. And age of onset is generally the middle to late years, that is above 6 years, 6 to 10 years. Then mitral valvular insufficiency, MVI, has also been reported along with this particular disease, but it is not mandatory. Histopathologically, if you see, there is a fibrosis of nodular tissues with vascular disturbances. That is, there is a microcoronary arteritis. Histopathological findings with the dogs suffering from this particular syndrome, sick sinus syndrome. Then electrocardiographic findings, repeated ECGs with a long tracing of 2 to 3 minutes to study all the features. As I told you, we take a run to find out the incidence of or occurrence of the VPCs or premature complexes. And therefore, in such cases, you have to take a tracing of 2 to 3 minutes. Let the machine run for 2 to 3 minutes, and then you evaluate that strip, the big strip, what you get. So, and study all these features, that is sinus bradycardia, first and second degree heart block, prolonged sinus pauses with variable escape beats and burst of supraventricular tachycardia. So all these features you may record in the ECG. And in some schnauzers, only bradycardia is reported. So in this case, you can see the first normal beat, second normal beat, thereafter there's only no activity, absolutely no escape beat, nothing. So for more than 3 seconds, there was no cardiac activity. The 168 blocks, I calculated them, it is 168 blocks. And therefore, for more than 3 seconds, there are no beats. This is a extreme bradycardia. In this case here, again, there is long pause and then sudden shoot of tachycardia. And again, thereafter, there is a no heartbeat. So that is a bradycardia. So here we can see the normal interval. Then there is again a pause, that is the sinus block. And then here, from here, there is a tachycardia and then the bradycardia. So it's a bradycardia tachycardia syndrome. Again, here you can see the very long pauses in the cardiac cycle. So here there's extreme, so in such cases, the patients even may can collapse. Then you can see the junctional rhythm. The P waves are negative. So this is the junctional rhythm. And since junctional beats are dominating the rhythm strip, there is a junctional rhythm. So this was about the one topic what we are going, we were supposed to discuss today. And we'll meet after 15 minutes for our second topic, that is the aberrant conduction, which also today is a small topic. Mukesh?
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
We'll meet after 15 minutes.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your first half of the session. Over to Dr. Mukesh, sir. Please, sir.
This is very important message for the participant.
Yes, sir. Mukesh, sir. Thank you very much, sir. So we have seen in the first half and since last 5 days, we are 6 days, we are seeing that we have Dr. Rajan Belankar, sir. One thing I wanted to tell you that Dr. Belankar, sir, is not only a very good clinician and academician, but he is also, he is actually rich in versatility. So he is having expertise in other activities also. So I would like to share some of his, you know, some extra curricular other activities also with you. So just give me a second, I'll start share something very special about sir. So you can see sir performing a very good whistling on this song Chandan Sabadan.
Dr. Amit?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, actually, you know, I think, you know, participants are not listening this or it's not audible. Have you played this?
Yeah.
It's not audible. I think so. Can I ask Mukesh sir, Dr. Dhomre?
Yes, sir. It is not audible and also it is not visible, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. Can you just replay the same?
Yeah, sure. Can you see all?
Now it is okay.
Now I can see.
Is it audible?
Yes, Dr. Amit, is audible
also.
Then I'll move it back so that you all the participants they can see from the beginning.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Dr. Amit?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, yes, sir.
Please play other video.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Mukesh.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So, Dr. Mukesh, sir. So,
hopefully, participant has enjoyed much the whistle playing of Valankar, sir. And for more videos, you can connect to Facebook page of Valankar, sir. So you can get number of videos that you can enjoy and relax yourself. Now, Dr. Amit, you want to take one or two participants? Otherwise, we can take it in the last of video.
Sir, as you suggest, or if you suggest, I can just take the opinion of one participant, any one participant, yeah, the one who is raising the hand for the first.
Okay. Dr. Amit, please, go ahead.
Any one participant, if he wants to say something.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, please raise your hand if anybody. Immediately I'll make him co-host and he will be allowed to share. Just raise your hand, anybody. Sir, I can see here two are clapping for this.
Mano Sharma has raised his hands.
Mano Sharma, yeah. I'll make him co-host and then he can unmute himself.
Yes.
Yeah. Dr. Mano Sharma, now you are co-host and you can unmute yourself, please.
Good evening to all of you. At the very onset, I would like to offer my sincere gratitude to Alembic Pharmaceutical for giving me the opportunity to be a part of this wonderful session. And as well as I would also like to thank Valankar sir, who has nicely given so many presentations which have really cleared up many of my confusions. And lastly, I would like to request the organizer to share the link of all this video to all the participants, and this will be a very good thing for all the participants, I suppose. And at last, thanks for the organizer or the organizing committee to organize such a wonderful session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Mano. The link for videos available at the YouTube channel of the BIPM Society. You can go on YouTube social media unit BIPM. So from that place, you can get the all the videos after completion of this course. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Dr. Amit.
Yes, sir. I think as per your suggestion, I think sir Valankar sir is already in. So if you suggest, we can go ahead, sir.
Yeah, please start.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Well, session over to Dr. Valankar, sir.
Good afternoon, participants. In our last session for this training program, that is the aberrant conduction. And this is also going to be a very short presentation, not as exhaustive as we are now having habit to it for sitting for nearly one and a half hour. So this will be a very short the lecture, and that is the on aberrant conduction. That is the pre-excitation syndrome. Now, pre-excitation syndrome means here the ventricles are, atria are depolarized. One second. In this syndrome, it includes the conduction disturbances that arise because of the conduction occurring through the pathways other than the normal conduction pathway. And therefore, we call it these pathways, we call them as accessory conduction pathways, and the conduction is called as aberrant conduction because they are not conducted through their normal route of SNO2 Purkinje fiber, but they are conducted by some other way, and therefore we call it as conduction pathway. And this was one of the way we learned in the physiopathology of arrhythmia, the re-entry mechanism, it can occur because of such type of pathways or such type of conducted impulses. So these pathways short circuit the normal conduction pathway and accelerate the conduction, producing supraventricular tachycardias. So that means it takes a short way than the normal pathway, and therefore you will find it speeds up, the accelerates the conduction and producing the supraventricular tachycardias. Classically, there are three types of high conductive tissues or the accessory pathways. Those have been identified. In human, all the three exist. In dog, only one has been identified. So we are not going to discuss the human part, but for dog, yes. And that also, it is a rare condition in dogs. So three types of bundles of high conductive tissues, that is the accessory pathways, have been identified. One is the Kent bundles connecting atria directly to the ventricles. Then James bundles that connect atria directly to the upper part of his bundle. And Mehem fibers that connect AV node directly to the ventricles. So these three conduction pathways have been identified. These are the special types of bundles of highly conductive tissues or accessory pathways. And now we'll study the Kent's bundle. Now, Kent bundles, we have seen while we studied the pathology of the physiopathology of arrhythmia, that now the Kent bundles connect atria to the ventricles. So this is the pathway. These are the atria. This is the SA node, then AV node, and these are the bundle branches, the right, the left, and left anterior, posterior. So these are the Kent bundles. So these Kent bundles directly connect the atria to the ventricles. And therefore, in these cases, what happens? The impulse directly passes from SA node, if they get activated, then directly to the ventricles. And therefore, before the impulse through the AV node depolarizes the ventricle, the ventricles are depolarized by this. And then this impulse even can travel in the retrograde manner through the AV node, and then it forms a, what you call it as the circus mechanism type of arrhythmia, rapidly depolarizing the ventricles at a very fast rate, and then producing the circus type of movement of arrhythmia or the re-entry, and then producing the supraventricular tachycardia. So these directly connect atria to the ventricles. And on ECG, you will find there is an anterograde passage of sinus impulse through the Kent bundle, producing shorter PR interval. Now, since the impulse that is coming to the directly through the Kent's bundle to the ventricle and depolarizing it, naturally, the distance between the P wave and the QRS complexes reduces, and therefore there will be very short PR interval, which is less than 0.06 seconds. So this is one of the identifying criteria for this particular type of arrhythmia. Now, the notching of the QRS complexes by the delta wave, which indicate premature depolarization of the part of the ventricle. This is because the impulse comes from the SA node via Kent bundle and not through the AV node, going entirely spreading to the Purkinje fibers, and therefore some part gets a prematurely depolarized. Therefore, you'll find there is a notching, or it is called as there is notching at the upstroke of the R wave, which I'll show you on the ECG how it looks like. That is called as the delta wave. It's a slurring of the upstroke, what they call it as the slurring of the upstroke of the R wave. Now, in normal sinus impulse travels in an anterograde fashion, Now, such condition is referred to as Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome or WPW syndrome. And we have seen there were two parts when we discussed during the physiopathology of arrhythmia. There are two parts. One was a micro reentry mechanism. So in micro reentry, we have seen it's atrial fibrillation. And whereas in this case, and there was a global entry, global reentry. So here it's a global reentry that impulse from atrium enters to the ventricle and then again it recirculates through the AV node and through the conduction system and then producing a circus type of movement. That is what is called as, and therefore it is called as macro reentry, not the micro. So it's a macro reentry or the global reentry. Now, such a condition is referred to as Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome or WPW syndrome. Now, it is rare in dogs and slightly less in cats. In cats, it is associated with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Now, in this case, you'll find the PR interval is hardly 3 blocks. So it is 0.06 seconds. And you'll find that there is a here upstroke. You'll find there is a, this is called a delta wave, slight notching of the P wave. The P wave comes here and then straightens up here. So this formation, this is notch. This is called as the delta wave. And this is the upstroke of the P wave. And this is the R wave. And this is the downstroke. So there is a slurring or notching of the upstroke of the R wave. So this is a characteristic finding of, you can see it here, part here and then it straightens up and goes up. So this notching is called as the delta wave, and it is a characteristic identification criteria for Wolff-Parkinson syndrome. The presence of short PR interval and the presence of delta wave on the upstroke of the R wave. You can find here, see. So this notching, otherwise you get the P wave directly straight up. So here you'll find that notching is there. So this notching is the characteristic, or it's a delta wave and characteristic of WPW syndrome. So the synonyms of WPW syndrome are accessory atrioventricular pathways, pre-excitation syndrome, WPW syndrome. Now, associations, this is a rare abnormality in dogs and cats. Its significance is unknown, but described in veterinary literature by Patterson. In human, it occurs as a congenital abnormality. The extra electrical pathways in patients with WPW syndrome bypass the normal route and causes ventricle to beat earlier than normal. That is, therefore, it is called as the pre-excitation and can allow electrical impulses to be conducted in both the directions, from atria to the ventricles or from ventricles to the atria. So this circus mechanism is called as the global reentry or macro reentry mechanism. Now, clinical signs, there are no clinical signs have been reported in dogs. In man, episodes of supraventricular tachycardia are distressing to the patient. No specific physical findings are present in this arrhythmia. Only thing on the ECG, you can find a very short PR interval and you'll find a delta wave on the upstroke of the R wave. So heart rate is normal, ECG findings, rhythm regular or sinus arrhythmia present, and P wave for QRS and QRS for P wave. The PR interval is constant, but it is short. It is less than 0.06 seconds. P waves are normal, but QRS complexes are prolonged and they are aberrant. Slurring of upstroke of R wave, that is delta wave, is present. So this is a criteria, the number one and number two. These are the identifying criteria for the condition that it is a WPW syndrome. Now, treatment, carotid sinus massage. It allows AV, slows the AV conduction. Then amiodarone you can use, which is an excellent supraventricular antiarrhythmic. As I told you, it has been a broad spectrum antiarrhythmic. Digoxin is contraindicated. Then surgical correction with limited success in man, because here you have to map the endocardial and epicardial accessory pathways, and then you have to interrupt them surgically. That is, the ablation has been recommended. Then only it relieves the patient from those unwanted tachycardia that is occurring, and that exhausts them. So here we come to the end of the academic portion for this particular that was planned. And
hello.
And so I say this is just the beginning.
Yes, sir. It is the beginning.
This is just the beginning. I have tried to explain whatever I know a little. And now with the help of the books and the further readings, I've given you the basic ideas. At least you are now not a novice for the terms what you will be reading in your journals or the books or in the articles you get. So now only I expect from you to just read further and then expand your knowledge. Because reading is going to keep you updated, and reading will clear up your more and more doubts. As you read more, your doubts get clearer faster. And I wish you all the best. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. That tomorrow's session is for the this discussion on the queries of the participants, sir. So I will request all the participants to what difficulty you face or what queries in your mind, to kindly mail to mail ID shared by Dr. Amit Singh. So you can mail your queries, so we will address your queries, and sir will solve the problems. So meanwhile, Dr. Amit, kindly invite anybody from the participant to put his opinion about our program. Dr. Amit.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So Dr. Pradeep Sharma is there. Dr. Pradeep Sharma, sir.
Hello, sir. I am audible, sir. Please, I am audible.
Yeah, sir. You are audible. Sir, you are requested. Please, sir, share some of your views and regarding this session. Please, sir.
And, okay, sir. Thank you, Dr. Mukesh and his team. First of all, I am Dr. Pradeep Sharma, and I am working as an assistant professor in the veterinary medicine department of Himachal Pradesh Krishi Vishwavidyalaya Palampur. I would like to thank Dr. Rajendra Velankar, sir, for sharing his vast knowledge and practical experiences on the basics of electrocardiography in dogs. Secondly, I would like to thank Alembic Pharmaceutical Limited for organizing this important e-course. Thirdly, special thanks to Veterinary Internal and Preventive Veterinary Medicine Society, Dr. A.K. Vikani, sir, president of the society, Dr. Ashok, sir, general secretary of the society, and Dr. Mukesh Srivastava, organizing secretary, and his team for selecting this informative, important 7 days e-course on basics of electrocardiography in dogs. Regarding the program, I would like to say that the selected topic is especially important, very nicely presented, and was a need of ours for young growing veterinarians, especially who are doing the small animal practice. Probably we all have the electrocardiographic machine in our clinical practice, but I am not sure how many of us are using it sincerely, routinely, or utilizing this facility frequently. If not, probably the reason is that we are lacking in the basics of electrocardiography. That is, how to do ECG, how to interpret ECG, how to correlate ECG findings with the disease diagnosis, and if done, then what treatment need to be done. So I sincerely appreciate Dr. Rajendra Velankar, sir, that he has taught or explained this topic right from the basics of electrocardiography, what we need to do, how to start an ECG machine, then how to analyze the ECG data, most importantly, interpretation of electrocardiography. its clinical application, then correlating the HCG findings with the physical examination and the clinical symptoms, and then last but not least, the most important treatment of heart-related disorders or the conditions in small animal practice. Thank you, sir. It's appreciating, and I said that it should be highly informative, and it would be informative. I'm pretty sure that all the participants, including me, have learned a lot from this e-course, and surely we will apply these skills practically in our day-to-day clinical practice, which would be helpful to our pet patients, our profession, and our institutes. At last, I would again like to thank organizers for selecting this important and informative topic and organizing this e-course, that too without any technical issue. I appreciate their efforts and personally suggest them to select more and more basics and practical topics related to small animal practice in the future courses. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pradeep Sharma, for sharing your opinion. And we will consider your opinion in future planning of our courses. In coming days, we are planning for basic sonography courses, abdominal sonography. So we are in the process, and we will announce for this course very soon. Thank you, Dr. Pradeep. Dr. Amit?
Yes, sir. So,
have you shared the mail ID for the participant question?
Yes, sir. I have shared the mail ID. I have messaged in chat box and to everyone. So all can see my mail ID. It is visible to all. I have already shared, and the mail ID I have shared in general for everyone. It will be visible to everyone.
Although two participants has raised their hands, so kindly make them co-host so can they can speak.
Yeah, I can see here Dr. Majid Ali is there, so I will make him co-host. He can unmute himself and he can share his views. Yeah, Dr. Majid Ali, sir. Yeah. Dr. Majid Ali, he can unmute himself, please.
Hello?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Yeah. It is so far as field practice concerned, especially in pet practice, it was a very nice. I felt think that it will be very nice for especially field vets. Okay. So far as electrocardiography is concerned, usually heart as is an important organ in your body. So far as clinical practice, clinically we analyze it and interpret it so far as CC is concerned.
I think some network issue is there, but Dr. Majid Ali is appreciating the session.
It is going to be very helpful.
If anybody else is there.
Thank you all there, all the participants. Thank you all.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Majid, due to poor connectivity. If anybody is more is there, you can take care. We have time.
Thank you, sir. Thanks. Yeah. Dr. Sumnil. There. Yeah. I'll make him co-host, and he can unmute himself, and he can share his views.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Good evening to all. I'm Sundil Marwa, PhD scholar from Luwas, and These lectures I have been attending from last 7 days. I found them immensely beneficial, for especially from the student perspective. And these are extensively explained. Even the basics are so very well explained that it has cleared many of doubts and explained many new things to the students also. And I really appreciate the effort of organizers also. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Mukesh, sir, please suggest, sir. I think now up to you, sir. Dr. Amit is there. Dr. Amit is there. He has raised his hand. So if you can allow, I'll make him co-host and he can also share his views. Mukesh, sir.
Please allow him, Dr. Sir.
Yeah. Okay, sir.
Hello, sir.
Dr. Amit, please share, sir.
The hardship.
Dr. Amit, please unmute yourself. I have made you co-host. You can unmute yourself and you can share your views. I think there is some connectivity issue. Okay.
Dr. Amit, today's session is over.
Yes, sir.
We discuss on tomorrow.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Vilankar, sir.
Yeah, have a good day to everybody.
Thank you, sir. We will meet on the same time tomorrow. Yeah. We will have some queries that I will mail you, sir, personally.
Okay.
So, accordingly, we will address the participant queries.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, yeah. Bye.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.